Hi, I'm Gordon, and in this video I'll show you how I built my very own vintage arcade machine based on a 3/4 scale Galaga cabinet from around 1981. I'll break down all of the decisions behind the build, how I resolved any issues or just ignored them, along with a shopping list of what I bought and how it all fitted together. Now, a bit like home baking, you don't embark on this sort of project to save money. It's all about the love of the build, along with the opportunity to introduce some unique customizations. For this particular build, the total cost was around 750 British pounds, although you may own a few parts that will allow you to save some money. For me, I already owned a TV set that I could reuse as a screen, so that saved me about £100. Now, there are of course a bunch of cheaper options available if you want to play some old arcade games. You could download them onto your phone or tablet or computer for starters, and there's a bunch of dedicated vintage consoles available that just plug straight into your TV set and do a great job. Now, these are all really, really fun, but I wanted a much more authentic experience, and that involved having an actual cabinet that was as authentic as possible to the original designs, with the same kind of artwork, the same kind of controls, and also the same kind of screen, and that meant using a cathode ray tube, just like an old tube TV. The actual pixels themselves glow in a different way. They are illuminated differently. So the style and the feeling that you get from an old CRT screen is very different from a modern flat TFT panel. And for me, I wanted that degree of authenticity. Now, if you're designing your own arcade machine, you're going to have to spend some time thinking about exactly what games you want to play and exactly what controls are going to be needed for it. And beyond that, the actual orientation of the display itself. Now, most modern games are designed to be played on horizontally oriented screens, whether they're widescreen displays of, say, a modern TV or something squarer like our old standard definition displays. But the kind of games that I really reminisce about and nostalgic about are those from the early 80s, where the screen was typically rotated 90 degrees into a vertical, taller orientation. Games like Pac-Man, Frogger, Space Invaders, Galaga, Galaxian, all of those had a vertical display. And for many years, I actually went back and forth trying to decide how I was going to accommodate everything I wanted to do in one machine. And while you're researching this, you'll come across a bunch of really innovative but rather complicated solutions. I've seen a lot of DIY builds where people have actually managed to rotate the screen within the cabinet, allowing them to play horizontal and vertical games. I've seen control panels that are packed with buttons, trackballs and spinners, or a more purist approach where people have designed maybe two or three different control panels that could either slot in or even rotate, giving you a cleaner, more authentic approach, but again, that ability to deploy those different games. But it was all getting way too complicated for me. I wanted something simple, something that reminded me of those games that I loved playing as a 10 or 11 year old going into those arcades in the early 80s. So I settled on a very simple short list of vertically oriented games. Again, Pac-Man, Frogger, Donkey Kong, Space Invaders, Galaga, Galaxian, Scramble, and a couple of others like Ladybug and Mr. Do. I was going to be satisfied with those games. If I want to play the fighting games with the multiple buttons from the late 80s or early 90s, I'm better off doing that with a games console connected to my TV set. This machine was about trying to relive an authentic experience from the early 80s, so I threw out all the complications and decided to keep it simple. Once I'd decided to emulate as best I could a vintage arcade machine, I had to decide exactly what kind of cabinet that should be, whether it was going to be one that I sat next to, the tabletop cocktail cabinet design, or an upright one that you'd stand up to play. There's also an interesting third option, a more modern option, which takes that upright design and basically saws it off underneath the screen so you can position that on a table. But again, for me, that wasn't particularly authentic, and they can also only work if you're using very thin flat panel displays. I was intending to use a much deeper cathode ray tube display, so that needed the full size of either a tabletop or an upright cabinet. And in the end, I opted for an upright. And looking through all the different designs of that era, the ones that most resonated with me, the ones that I thought were most attractive, were the Midway cabinets from around 1981, and in particular those from, say, Ms. Pac-Man or Galaga. Those were my favourite shapes. Now, once again, for an authentic experience, I wanted to use a cathode ray tube display. Again, this allows the games to play at their original resolutions, avoiding ugly scaling artifacts, and it also means that you're getting those nice glowing pixels that you remember from your childhood, or at least I do. Now, if you don't have a TV in the loft, or if one of your neighbours or friends doesn't have one that they can give you or sell you, they are still available. You can buy them secondhand from places like eBay, or even some auctions from some old broadcasting studios that are closing down. Now, I did a quick check while I made this video, and you're looking in the UK anyway at spending around £100 to £150 for a working condition CRT screen that's between, say, 14 and 20 inches in size. If you are shopping for a CRT, do try and look out for the original Sony broadcast monitors that were used in studios, because they have a lot more controls for the actual screen shape and geometry. They also always have really nice RGB inputs on them, which you want for the best quality. I couldn't find one of those, but luckily I did have my own 14-inch Sony Trinitron TV from about 20 years ago that I remember 2 decades ago actually earmarking for a future arcade machine project. It is something that I have been working on for rather a long time, but at least it's now complete. So I'd kept that TV aside for this project in mind. Now, it's a 14-inch screen, and most of these arcade machines used, say, maybe 18 to 20-inch displays. But I thought this was a good opportunity to scale down the entire cabinet, and I used the actual size of this Sony TV set to drive the scale of the whole project, and it would work out at roughly 3/4 actual size. Now, when I first thought about this project 20 years ago, the way that most vintage arcade machines were built was using software running on an old desktop PC that you might have lying around, or perhaps an aging laptop. And these in turn had to be fitted with special graphics cards or drivers in order to generate those custom resolutions needed to play those old games authentically. But if you were then going to connect it to a TV set and not a computer monitor, you needed some quite complicated wiring to get it all to work. It really was pretty complicated and sometimes quite expensive to achieve. But fast forward 2 decades, which my procrastination has allowed me to do, and there are much simpler and cheaper solutions available. For starters, the kind of computer that you need to run this kind of software has become a lot simpler and cheaper. You can actually run all of the emulation you want up until games to roughly the early 90s, or certainly the late 80s, on something as simple as a Raspberry Pi Model 3. And this is a tiny computer that's roughly the size of a credit card. I bought one, again, the Model 3, with a 5-volt power supply for just £41.10. And that has sufficient computational power to run all of the games that I require. But the real game changer, the really clever part, is how the Raspberry Pi is connected to my old TV set. And it's done with just one single simple product called the RGB Pi. And this was developed by an enthusiast in Spain, and it costs just around £32, including delivery to the UK. And it is pretty much just a cable that connects to the GPIO pins on the Raspberry Pi at one end, and on the other end, it's got an RGB SCART that you plug into the back of any TV. The really clever part is once you buy this cable, it unlocks a downloadable software image that contains not just a bootable operating system for a Raspberry Pi, but also a complete front end for running all of these old vintage games, along with emulating exactly the resolutions and display frequencies that are required. All you need to do is find some game ROMs, drop them in, and you've got a fully working system. It's absolutely fantastic, and I cannot recommend the RGB Pi highly enough. It has just transformed this entire project. Now, at this point, you could simply connect a USB keyboard to your Raspberry Pi or any other computer that you're using to run the software and start playing the games. However, I wanted a more authentic experience with proper traditional arcade buttons and joysticks. Unfortunately, these are available from a bunch of specialist dealers. I mostly used Ultimark and Arcade World to buy most of my parts. I'll put links in the description below. And in particular, I'd like to give a big thanks to Andy Warne and his patience and unrivaled technical support over the many years that I've been emailing him at Ultimark. And it's quite funny to look back at my emails to him 20 years ago when we were discussing arcade VGA graphics cards for connecting a desktop PC to an old TV set, and now fast forwarding to the much more simple solutions that I'm looking at now. But the buttons haven't changed. If you do want to use proper authentic arcade controls, though, you're going to need something called a keyboard encoder. Now, Keyboard Encoder is a pretty simple device. It's just a circuit board, small circuit board, with a bunch of connectors on one side for your buttons and joysticks, and a single wire that comes out the other. They're typically USB that will connect to your computer. And what they do is basically turn those button presses and joystick moves into actual characters from a keyboard, which are then used to drive the software and play the game. Now, when I was originally thinking about using a desktop PC for this project, I bought one of Ultimark's mini-pack keyboard encoders, which is really extremely capable and comes with fantastic software for Windows, and you can also run it under Mac OS. It allows you to remap all of those buttons, and the version I bought also supported optical devices like spinners and trackballs. But the project that I ended up building was much simpler than that, and it was not running under Windows. It needed to run under the operating system that was used by the RGB Pi system. And unfortunately, it didn't talk very well with the mini pack. So I've saved that for a different project. And instead, I just bought the simplest keyboard encoder that the RGB Pi forums, which are very helpful, by the way, explained just worked straight out of the box. And it did. I bought a QEMAT. I think is how you pronounce it, a QEMAT zero delay encoder, which cost me £10.99. And once I plugged that in to the Raspberry Pi, well, the RGB Pi front end just recognized it straight away, and I was in business. Now, when it came to actually shopping for the specific controls that I needed for this particular project, I thought it would be simple because, after all, I'd already decided that I wanted to, as closely as possible, recreate a Gallagher cabinet with the same controls and artwork as an original machine from 1981. All I needed to do was find a photo of one of those original cabinets and just copy it as closely as possible, right? But when you start looking into this, you realize that no two cabinets are the same. They come from different factories. There are different regional variations. Some regions prefer buttons that are concave, dip in the middle. Other regions prefer ones that are rounded upwards. Some cabinets have been broken and repaired or even transformed from a different game. And the person who's doing that may have run out of red buttons and, you know, sees no problem in fitting a yellow or a green or a blue button instead. But what this means is that if you're like me, are trying to figure out exactly what the original looked like, you're going to find it really hard. In fact, next to impossible. And you're going to have to start making your own decisions based on how you want it to look. A case in point for me was that when I first started shopping for this, I decided to buy some buttons that had the player one and player two icons actually printed on the buttons themselves. But then I realized that the artwork had the player one and two icons already on it. And then I found a bunch of photos of Gallagher cabinets that, instead of having white buttons for the player one and two, they had yellow buttons. And because I'd found more of those, I ended up switching the white for the yellow. And it's a rabbit hole that you can go down very, very, very deeply. But eventually, I settled on a configuration that looked pretty similar to most of the photos that I saw. And most importantly, it looked nice to me. So the buttons are fortunately cheaper than you think. You're only looking at a couple of pounds for a good quality gold leaf button. In terms of a joystick, though, this was actually a bit more complicated because Gallagher only had a left and right joystick. And in fact, the groove cutout on the cabinet constrained it to only move left and right, which is fine if you're only playing Gallagher and Space Invaders, but it's no good if you're playing Pac-Man or Frogger or Scramble or any of those games where you need to go up and down as well. And when you look into this, you realize that some games also allowed an eight-way position on the joystick, but some were very strict in only working with four-way controllers. So you start thinking, what kind of joystick do I get? Do I get one that has a two-way, a four-way, or an eight-way? In the end, I went for a kind of technical compromise, which was the MagStick from Ultimark, which allows you to switch it between four and eight-way constrictions by actually pulling the joystick up and rotating it and letting it drop back down again. And that seems to work quite well. I also like the feel of it. All of these different joysticks feel different. And again, you're trying to emulate the kind of joystick you remember playing with when you were only 10 years old. I don't exactly remember how that joystick felt, but I quite liked the way the MagStick felt, and that was the most important thing. But you'll find different joysticks move different amounts, different amount of play, but also the ball on the top. Now, the MagStick comes with a bat shape top to the stick, which looks really nice, but most of the Gallagher photos that I was finding had a ball shaped top. But luckily, Ultimark will sell you a ball shaped top if you prefer to screw that on. Now, when you are thinking about buttons, it's also important to think about how you're going to operate this machine, because presumably, even if it's very simple like mine, it's still going to be playing more than one game. So you need some means by which to exit the game, and that wasn't ever present on the original control panel. You are going to probably need an extra button to exit that and get back to your main menu system. Also remember that if you are emulating vintage arcade games, these were all coin-operated games. So the game itself is waiting for a coin to be inserted before it will give you a credit. You need a credit before you can choose whether to play player one or player two. So you're going to need either a button or an actual coin mechanism in order to send that command. And even if you do go for a coin mechanism, I would recommend still accommodating a duplicate button somewhere on the cabinet that emulates the idea of inserting a coin, because in my experience later on, you're going to need that. In total, I spent £61.98 on all of the buttons and joysticks and wiring from Ultimark for this project. Now, there's one other catch, one other gotcha you've got to be aware of if you're doing a scaled down project like mine. Now, I was scaling everything down by 3/4 compared to the original size, but I was using original size buttons. I wasn't using 3/4 scale buttons because they're not available. And what this means is that the holes on the control panel are going to end up being too small and too close together. So you're going to have to redesign the control panel a bit. You're going to have to space them apart so that the bigger buttons are going to fit. You're also going to have to rework the artworks if you're in particular about this sort of thing, and I'll show you how I did that later on in this video. But you're also going to have to spend a little bit of time thinking about how you're going to be playing this machine and how it's going to actually feel in practice. Now, the original full-size machines had plenty of space on the control panels for you to rest your wrists. But if you're scaling this down to a smaller size, it's going to mean less space. And some of those buttons and joysticks, if you're scaling them to the same sort of proportions as they were in the original, I found that they were too close to the edges. Now, I wasn't quite sure about how I was going to handle this, so I actually made two different control panel designs. One that perfectly matched a scaled down version of the original, but obviously with enlarged holes for the joystick and buttons, but one where I'd shifted the buttons inwards a little to give me more space to rest my wrist. And that is actually the one that I ended up using on the final build. And hey, guess what? You cannot tell. If you look at that, I don't think you're going to say, oh, that's not original control panel. He's moved it to the side. It's not quite right. I was actually worried about this when I was designing it, that it would stand out. It doesn't stand out, but it's a very important step to consider to make it much more comfortable to play. Because after all, you don't want to create something that looks perfect, but is unplayable in practice.